Dear friends, followers, welcome back to my channel and to a great video about a common question: what and how do you perform a outside check? I'll take you around an entire exterior walk around of my former airplane, the Airbus A320. So let's put on that high visibility vest and let's get started.
Singapore 221, finally welcome to sunny Sydney, exit left, contact ground 1217.
I'm sure you might have experienced this once you were waiting at the gate prior to boarding. You spot the pilot walking around the aircraft and closely looking at the exterior of his aircraft. Now, every pilot has to check if his aircraft, helicopter, glider, little sports plane, military or commercial jet, hasn't encountered any damage from previous flights or shows any leakages. Aviators call this regular procedure the outside check or the exterior walkaround. After completing your first checks within the cockpit, the last item on the preliminary cockpit preparation checklist reads exterior walkaround perform. So the aircraft manual lists the items which should be inspected whilst doing your outside check. But before you set off, there are a few things you need to do before commencing that check. Don't step out on the apron without a high visibility vest. You'll be surprised how many accidents happen around airplanes, so do yourself a favor and wear that vest. I don't care if it looks stupid, but I want to see your look on your face if you have to pay the $300 fine. Wear ear protection, especially on passenger jets. The air conditioning packs might be running whilst you perform your check, and they are so loud as if a fighter jet is taking off right next to you. And just a hint, your hearing gets checked in every medical, so wear earplugs or earmuffs. During night operation, bring a powerful flashlight. Do not use your mobile phone, that's a complete joke, that light. Also, quite helpful is to turn on the wing light and logo light to check for any contamination on those surfaces. And before you set off, set the parking brake in order to check the brake wear indicators on the main landing gear, but I'll come back to that in a minute. Okay, as you step out onto the jetway staircase, you can quickly spot if there's any snow resting on the wing's upper surface, so you immediately want to inform airport authorities to sign you up for de-icing, or otherwise you're going to have to wait at the end of the queue. Now, to get an even closer look at the wing surface, either look through one of the passenger windows or ask the refueler if you can use his staircase, as in this picture. Then start at the left of the forward fuselage, check that the captain's angle of attack probe isn't damaged in any way, and closely look at the captain's and first officer's static ports. Make sure they are clean of any debris. Make sure the avionics equipment inlet valve is not damaged or obstructed. I have seen pilots doing the walk around with an umbrella as their hair could get wet and ruin the next Instagram picture. And then getting too close to the inlet, the suction is so strong that it can easily destroy the umbrella and damage the inlet. What I'm trying to say here, do not use an umbrella for external walkarounds. Walk towards the nose wheel, check that the chocks are in place and the condition of the tires. The wheels and the tires should have no cuts and cracks, and ensure that the park brake indicator light is illuminated, showing that the parking brake is set. Look for any hydraulic line leakages and that the nose gear safety pin is removed. If you forget that, the nose gear won't retract upon takeoff. Make sure that the takeoff and taxi lights, such as the two smaller runway turnoff lights below, have no burnt out light bulbs or cracks. Then check for the green crew oxygen overboard discharge indicator disc. If it were missing, it indicates an overpressure in the system has been detected, and then you want to call for maintenance. Walking towards the nose, you check that both pitot tubes are clean and that they're removed before flight covers have been removed. Also, the upper standby static port needs to be clean. If the ground electrical power is connected, the security strap must be hooked to prevent the plug from falling out, and look for the condition of the total air temperature sensors and the DME1 antenna that they are clean. Then go a few steps back to get a good look at the nose radome. Look for cracks, bird strikes or lightning burn marks, and check that the latches are securely fastened. This is also a good spot to get an overview of the slats on either wing for any recent bird strike. check the second standby static port and the first officer's pitot probe, check the condition of the avionics equipment, ventilation, air, outlet valve. If it's not closed, as in this video, there's a strong outflow of warm air which will ruin your hairdo if you pass it too closely. Further down, check that the first officer and captain static ports are clean and their covers are removed, and ensure that the first officer's angle of attack probe is in good shape. Here it's slightly hidden behind the open cargo door, so make sure to check again once it's closed. Walk below the fuselage, check that the ATC and the DME2 antennas are okay, such as the TCAS and the forward portable drain mast and marker antenna. Check the air conditioning pack inlet is free and not blocked by ground equipment. Look for any damages at the wing root and verify that the fuel level indicators are flush with the wing and that there is no leak from the fuel water drain. Then walk across to engine number 2, give the fan a little spin and check for any unfamiliar sounds. Check that the fan blades aren't bent or cracked and that the spinner is mounted properly. Look for any blockages in the generator cooling inlet and engine anti-ice outlet. Check for any missing panels on the engine pylon and then look into the bypass section of the engine to spot any leakages around the reverser door actuators and if any of the stator blades are loose. Also, you don't want to see any leakages or damages in the turbine outlet. Then walking to the right-hand wing leading edge, check the condition of the slats. Make sure the refuel coupling filler cap is closed and verify that the fuel level indicators are flush with the wing and that there is no leak from the fuel water drain valve. Verify that the surge tank air inlet is clear and that the overpressure disc isn't cracked or missing. Check that the navigation and strobe lights aren't damaged, such as the wingtips, and check if there are any static discharges broken or missing. From this angle, you can quickly scan if any of the upper fuselage antennas are broken or missing. Now, the ailerons should be hanging down as there shouldn't be any hydraulic pressure. Make sure that the flaps and control surfaces are in the correct position and none of the flap track fairings are damaged and flush with the lower surface of the wing. Now let's look at the right landing gear. Now check that none of the wheel nuts are missing. Make sure there aren't any deep cuts on the sidewalls and overall wear of the tires. And if so, call maintenance and they'll change a tire within minutes. Look for any damages of the brake fan. Now here I'm pointing out the brake wear indicators I've mentioned before. If any of the indicators are flush with the guide, call for maintenance and have the brake swapped. It won't take them very long either. Now check if any hydraulic lines are damaged or leaking. If it doesn't look good, call maintenance. Observe the landing gear main structure. Now there are limits on how much the main strut can be compressed, potentially indicating a hard landing. At the downward lock springs, ensure that the safety pin is removed. Again, if you forget that, you can't retract the gear upon takeoff. Therefore, they come with a very large remove before flight tag. Now make sure the landing light isn't broken or burnt out and that the air conditioning pack outlet is free. Then walk towards the VHF antenna and make sure it's attached properly and nothing is blocking the radio altimeter, transmitters and receivers. As you walk further back, check the correct position of the outflow valve and the aft potable water drain mast. Now you can often spot damages on the horizontal stabilizer and elevator as minor stones and gravel can get picked up by the main landing gear and slam those against the lower surface. So make sure you don't spot any holes and cracks. Again, check for the static discharges, and if you have the time and the aft staircase is placed, run up the staircase and get an even better view of the horizontal and vertical stabilizer. So monitor the vertical stabilizer, the fin and rudder, the APU inlet and outlet, the fire extinguisher overpressure disc is in place, and the rear navigation light for any damages. Then slowly walk along the aft part of the fuselage as you can spot any tail strike mishaps or ripples on the outer skin indicating severe structural wear. When reaching the center fuselage, ensure that all doors are closed and latched, such as the ground hydraulic connection for blue and green door and the hydraulic reservoir filling door. Make sure the air conditioning pack inlet door is free of obstructions and that the anti-collision light isn't damaged. Then we'll examine the left landing gear as we did on the other side, and also the wing's trailing and leading edge, plus the second roof fuel coupling and engine number one, and that the ram air turbine housing is properly closed. Now, I want to point out that we didn't have to check if all smaller panel doors were closed, as sometimes either maintenance was performing some work or ground crew used the service panels for their operation, because as we request pushback, the pushback driver will perform another thorough outside check after all ground crew and maintenance have removed their equipment, and he'll make sure that all panels and doors are securely closed and flush with the fuselage. Obviously, if you're flying your little Cessna, that's your responsibility to look out for such panels. Kind reminder, make sure the fuel cap is securely fastened. Many flight students know what I'm talking about. And once you get back into the cockpit, continuing your preparations, you write down the time you started and ended a check plus your signature into the technical flight log to approve that you have completed the outside check. Important, this is not a once in a day check. No, the outside check has to be performed prior to every flight. And as mentioned before, this procedure applies for little sports planes, private jets and helicopters, although these aircrafts fly on a less regular basis, so their vulnerable instruments, the engines, inlets and outlets, are covered with a red protective cover marked with big letters "remove before flight". And safety bolts, which protect the rudders from flapping about in the wind, are also tagged with this warning sign. If you want to learn more about that, check out my other video about the remove before flight tags. So in the event that something is malfunctioning or broken, we'll request a certified technician for help. If he can repair the broken part, he'll state his repairs in the technical flight log and approves that the aircraft is airworthy. Otherwise, if new parts or bigger inspections and repairs are needed, he'll write it off and the aircraft is then AOG. Now, I would like you to comment below which part of the outside check you would like me to do a more detailed video on, like was an antenna or an instrument you didn't really understand, just let me know. And by the way, I have seen remote control pilots performing outside checks on their planes, and that walk around definitely doesn't take as long as circling a Boeing 747. That's it for today. Thank you very much for your time. To become my wingman, hit the subscribe button and the notification bell so you won't miss out upcoming videos. And don't forget, a good pilot is always learning. See you next week. All the best, your Captain Joe.